And there was this event this weekend, the White House Correspondents' Dinner, and that is when the media and the White House and politicians get together, and usually tips are exchanged in some way, shape, or form, even a wink, nothing. Before we go to David Gregory, let's take a look at Seth Meyers, who made a bin Laden joke, and you can see the president responding or not. Take a look.
People think bin Laden is hiding in the Hindu Kush, but did you know that every day from 4 to 5 he hosts a show on C-SPAN?
No.
David Gregory, that is what you call a poker face.
It was one of the funnier lines of the night.
But look at that smile. It is, for so many people, remarkable that even at that point he knew.
And now it means so much more looking at it.
That something very big was happening.
Look, it's a reminder of how little we sometimes know about what's going on inside the government. Look how long this has been an operation that's been underway, that intelligence has been gathered at a time when the president's rivals have been criticizing him for failing to lead in the area of national security, failing to pursue as robust a counterterrorism policy as his predecessor, President Bush. And yet it was every bit as robust. And indeed, one of the big stories in the area of the war on terror is the continuity between one administration to the next. One of the reasons that bin Laden was effectively shut down in his capacity as command and control of al-Qaeda was because of the work that was done over the years following 9/11 that had him on the run, that had him living this way, although ironically, for all the thought, even talking to military officials as I did last summer in Afghanistan, the thinking that he was buried deep away in the mountainous region of Pakistan appears to be untrue, at least where they found him. But again, how little we know about what's going on and how important an operation like this is to gather steam on, to gather intelligence for, and to ultimately execute.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, David, I was watching Meet the Press, as I do every Sunday, yesterday.
Religiously.
Part of the conversation, of course, was on the birth certificate. Do you think we have finally turned the page and we don't have to raise this question anymore, and we can move on and talk about serious things because this is such a serious development, Barnacle?
Well, before David answers, and in addition to answering your question, David, do you think that that people like Trump will now demand to see a death certificate?
I mean, seriously.
Well, you know, but that's actually not not having to do with Donald Trump. But, you know, as we were gathering this information last night, as we were reporting the story out, a key piece of it from government officials was that the United States had his body. That would be tremendously important. I was thinking back to when Saddam Hussein was captured and the images were released of him being inspected by a military doctor. Proof of life or proof of death in this case is going to be very important for the rest of the world, for America, but ultimately proof that it was he who was captured rather than somehow still being on the run, which is underscores the importance. And yes, Mika, I do think this moves the needle a great deal past the silliness of what we've been talking about in politics and beyond. This is a huge leadership moment for any president and for this president as well. You have to add that there's continuity in this operation. This is the strength of the military as well as the CIA, of course, in pursuing this over a long period of time and, of course, putting bin Laden on the run. But as David Ignatius has talked about, Roger Cressy and others, as your father would talk about, Mika, the diffuse nature of the threat. We think back to the Christmas Day bombing last year. This was not Osama bin Laden pulling the strings on this. This was this franchise quality to al-Qaeda, a diffuse threat where they're throwing everything at the United States.
All right, David Gregory, thank you so much. And I want to follow up on what David talked about, Richard, continuity. That is the word that we and I want to hear from you and everybody else. There was continuity. You know, there's all this back and forth and this screaming and the scratching and clawing in the political arena, but there was continuity between the Bush and the Obama administration. In the end, that may have made the difference.
Absolutely. The reorientation of U.S. intelligence resources, this became a priority after the Cold War. Indeed, it's the Cold War that I'm thinking of. One of the reasons, if not the principal reason, we prevailed in the Cold War over four decades is it really didn't matter a whole lot whether you had a Democratic president or a Republican president. American foreign policy largely was consistent. I'd say the same thing here. the reason that we've done as well as we've done, not just getting bin Laden, but essentially over the last decade since 9/11, not having any terrorist attacks, is that this has been a largely consistent policy across the board. It didn't change dramatically, even after the new administration came in and talked about major changes. In fact, the policy really didn't change all that much, and the military and intelligence parts in particular were largely extraordinarily familiar. Indeed, if a lot of the people who served in the previous administration stepped into their old jobs today, I think they'd be pretty comfortable with what it was they inherited.
You know, by the way, we asked David Gregory if he could stay with us. I thought he had to bump right over to the network, but fortunately, Willie, David's able to stick around.
Yeah, David, you talked about we in the press and people in the country not knowing exactly what goes on in the government at all times. Can you talk just briefly about how this unfolded for you last night? I know our BlackBerries were hit at about 9:45 last night, something like that. The president will speak at 10:30. At what point did you know that this was huge news?
Well, just hearing that the president was going to speak at 10:30 at night indicated to me that there was something big overseas. I think a lot of people felt instinctively that it was about Gaddafi and about Libya, particularly because of the bombing the night before. You talk about the correspondence dinner. I spoke to senior intelligence officials and military officials, one of whom was a guest of NBC News, about the need to monitor a situation. And we were talking about the NATO strike at that particular time in Libya. But, you know, even covering the story, as I have since 9/11, the notion of getting bin Laden was something that was not on my radar screen on a day-to-day basis. And so then as this unfolded, you realized we got word that it was bin Laden and that the president was about to speak. And it was just, you know, a huge moment as it continued to unfold. But immediately, the president's going to talk at 10:30 at night on a Sunday night. He's got something pretty major to announce.
Yeah, absolutely. And